What happens when two smartphones made by the same company go toe-to-toe? I'm Taylor Martin, this is Pocket Now, and this is the Droid Ultra versus the Moto X. Since being acquired by Google last May, Motorola Mobility has been mostly coasting. Sure, it's released the HD updates to the Droid Razr line, only for the hubbub to die weeks later. In July, however, Motorola announced three new phones for Verizon: the Droid Ultra, Droid Max, and Droid Mini. And at the beginning of this month, the Moto X was unveiled. In our labs, we currently have the Moto X and the Droid Ultra, and we put them head to head. Which one comes out on top? Let's find out. The biggest difference between all of Motorola's latest smartphones, oddly enough, is appearance and design. The Droid Mini, as the name alludes, is the smallest of the quartet. The Droid Ultra and the Droid Max with 5-inch displays are the largest, and the 4.7-inch Moto X rests perfectly in the middle. And on the outside, the Moto X has very little in common with its next of kin. The Droid Ultra is squared and industrial. The glossy plastic back makes it feel more like a Samsung Galaxy handset than something we've come to expect from Motorola. And its button controls along the side protrude with a harsh grooved aluminum that's impossible to miss. The power and volume rocker on the Moto X are a smooth finish and barely there, yet they're very firm and tactile. The texture buttons on the Ultra are mushy, yet grippy. Tiny differences like this extend throughout the hardware. The headphone jacks are on the top edge, but the Ultra's is to the right and the Moto X's is in the middle of a nice rounded bevel that blends into the back edge. The backside of the Ultra is flat and sort of bubbles on top to accommodate for the camera, which sits in the middle of a speaker grille. And the LED flash sits to the left instead of beneath, like on the Moto X. And of course, the Moto X is rounded on the back and slips right into the palm of your hand. The Motorola emblem on the Moto X is integrated inside a dimple that your index finger naturally slips into for additional grip. The Ultra's M logo is again a brushed aluminum that clashes with its glossy surroundings. And the navigation buttons on the Moto X are on screen. The Ultra and its Droid brethren feature capacitive navigation buttons. Oh, and lest we forget, the Droid Ultra has a neat trick up its sleeve. If you look around the edges, you will not find a slot for the nano SIM. The Moto X is quite obviously located on the left edge, but the Ultra SIM tray is hidden within the volume rocker. Use your fingernail to snag the notch and gently pull outwards. Clever indeed. And their dimensions differ as well. The Moto X measures 129.3mm tall, 65.3mm wide, 10.4mm thick, and it hits the scales at a fair 130 grams. It's 8.2mm shorter, 5.9mm narrower, 3.2mm thicker, and 7 grams lighter than its larger compatriot. Their outsides are clearly quite different. The Ultra is definitely more reminiscent of an older Motorola, while the Moto X is fresh and symbolic of starting anew. Internally, however, these two smartphones are nearly indistinguishable. They both come with 10-megapixel clear-pixel cameras, the X8 mobile computing system, which consists of a 1.7GHz dual-core Crate CPU, quad-core Adreno 320 GPU, a low-power CPU dedicated to contextual computing, and a final low-power core dedicated to natural language processing. They both have 2GB of RAM, 720p Super AMOLED displays, Wi-Fi BGNAC, NFC, LTE, Bluetooth 4.0, etc. The main differences in specifications are that the Moto X comes in either 16 or 32GB models, while the Ultra is confined to only 16GB. The Moto X has a 2200mAh battery to the Ultra's 2130mAh. If you want more capacity or a larger battery in your Verizon Droid, you will need to opt for the virtually identical Droid Max. And clearly, the display sizes are different. While we're on the topic of displays, both the Droid Ultra and Moto X use 720p Super AMOLED displays. At 4.7 diagonal inches, the Moto X has a slight advantage in pixel density, 312 pixels per inch to 294 pixels per inch on the Ultra's 5-inch display. As you would expect, they're neck and neck on brightness, contrast, black levels, viewing angle, saturation, etc. Really, the only difference between them is their size and, likewise, density, but only marginally so. There's also the hot topic of on-screen buttons taking up precious pixels and real estate. It's purely a preference thing. We like on-screen buttons, but we don't knock the Ultra for having capacitive buttons either. In the end, we give the edge in hardware to the Moto X. The glossy fingerprint magnet backside of the Droid Ultra is slightly disappointing. Despite the fact that we prefer the extra size of the Droid Ultra, the Moto X caters to the shape of our hands more nicely. And although the ability to customize the colors is limited for AT&T right now, the ability to do so is certainly worth noting. Honestly, we'd love nothing more than to have the Moto X in the size of the Droid Ultra. You would think, coming from Motorola and both being touted as flagship-esque devices, that the only major difference between the Moto X and Droid Ultra would be included bloatware, right? That assumption isn't entirely wrong, but strangely enough, both have unique Motorola features. They share some, the Droid Ultra has some to itself, and the Moto X has some of its own. It's just odd, and the only logical reason for that is Verizon having its hand in the software cookie jar. Both run Android 4.2.2, and both have touchless control, assist, migrate, Motorola Connect, and active notifications. The Droid Ultra comes with Droid Zap, the ability to share photos from within the Photos app with a two-finger swipe up, and some of Motorola's older touches, like the Droid Command Center widget. And the Moto X has Skip, the NFC unlock feature which no longer says it's compatible with the Ultra and Google Play, and trusted devices. Aside from those inconsistencies, there's nothing between the software on these two. They're both very nearly stock Android experiences, and the Moto X feels just a tiny bit more vanilla than the Droid Ultra. With the same unique chipset under their hoods, performance is exactly what you would expect from the two. Any differences are indistinguishable. They're both buttery smooth in average performance, switching between apps, opening and closing apps, etc. Multitasking and intensive gaming are great on both devices as well. Naturally, their performance in benchmarks is also similar. One of the more significant differences we've come across with these two devices is speaker quality. The rear loudspeaker on the Ultra is significantly and noticeably louder and more crisp than the speaker on the Moto X. It's also much more difficult to cover up. We've been using the Moto X on AT&T's LTE network in the Charlotte metro area, and the Droid Ultra is obviously a Verizon-only device. Data speeds and network performance is dependent upon many different factors, but we will note that we've averaged higher speeds with the Moto X on AT&T thus far. And battery life. We haven't had the Ultra long enough to fully test its battery efficiency. So far, the two seem to be discharging at approximately the same rate, taking into consideration that we've put the Droid Ultra through quite a bit more abuse today. As far as capacity goes, the Moto X has a slight advantage with a 2200 mAh battery to the Ultra's 2130 mAh battery. For more on battery life and network performance, keep an eye out for the full review. Finally, camera quality. Both feature the same camera sensors, 10 megapixel clear pixel sensors that utilize an additional clear pixel in the subpixel arrangement on the sensor to take in more light. The easy way to put it is, it's no optical image stabilization. Low light pictures are very muddy and lack lots of detail, and even in bright conditions there seems to be some higher level compression at play. Edges are soft and there just isn't the same level of detail we've seen from other smartphone cameras 8 or 13 megapixels. Comparatively, neither camera is amazing, and truthfully they're on par with one another, but it's worth noting that the Droid Ultra performed better in most situations. The Moto X had trouble with color reproduction. The Ultra produced fairly accurate shots, while the Moto X took images that sometimes looked milky, underexposed, or over-sharpened. This is a perfect testament to how important camera software optimization truly is. At the end of the day, there is no clear winner. There's hardly anything between them at all. Where one falls short, the other shines. So we ask you, which of these two devices would you declare the winner? It's a tough decision for sure. We like the size of the Droid Ultra better, but the build and design of the Moto X. The software on the Moto X is more useful and practical, but the Ultra's camera and loudspeaker are better. If we had to pick a winner, we'd give it to the Moto X, but only by the skin of its teeth, and for good reason. Availability and finish. The Moto X will launch on all four major US carriers, as well as US Cellular. The Droid Ultra is destined to remain on Verizon shelves forever. And come November, MotoMaker will be available to all. That's going to wrap up this comparison. If you enjoyed it, be sure to let us know by clicking the thumbs up button below and subscribing. Stay tuned for more Droid Ultra coverage over the next week or so with comparisons and a full review. And be sure to follow us in the usual places, Twitter, Google+, and Facebook at Pocket Now. You can find me on Twitter at Casper Tech. I'm Taylor Martin, and I will see you next week. I almost forgot. Yesterday, I left my hat at home, so a friend made a hat for me, and I told them I would wear it on video. It says, "Have a wonderful Labor Day weekend," so be sure to do that, and we'll see you next week.